Hello and welcome to the Grand Line Review, your source for everything One Piece. So recently I provided a list of my top 5 favorite characters within this wonderful series, and as a result I feel that it's only fair now that we move to the opposite end of the spectrum in order to showcase some characters who I certainly do not love. At the outset, I'd like to say that just because a character appears on this list does not mean I hate them. I honestly don't think that I hate any character in the series, and in fact I had a fair bit of difficulty composing this list because I'd go back and forth with things like, no, I mean I don't like them, but do they really deserve to be in my top 5 least favorite? So just be aware of that as we go on, and also please do not take personal offense at any of the characters I mention here today, because I actually think I've encountered people who hold the following 5 characters as their favorites in One Piece, and that's cool. I'm not saying they're bad, this is just a subjective investigation into what doesn't really work for me. And just something else I'd like to flag is that I won't be examining supremely minor characters because they just don't have a big enough impact on the story to be able to form any reasonable opinion on them. So characters like Farafra or Bachi are very much immune here today. Not that they would probably appear on this list anyway. They are so cool. And that is more or less the criteria for this list, with of course the addendum that all characters here today must be canon, because otherwise I would never be able to pick a mere 5 to be featured. But with that out of the way, let's begin. Welcome to my top 5 least favorite characters in One Piece. Number 5. Sabo. Now before you all click away from this video, just hear me out. This may be a controversial choice to some and very obvious choice for others, and I'd like to state that I definitely do not hate Sabo. I think he has a very cool design and he's fun to see in action, but overall he just leaves me with this overwhelming feeling of meh. And it's because to me he does feel a bit like a Poochie, you know, a character who was inserted into the story very artificially and somehow commands the kind of respect that was well earned by those before him. And of course I'm specifically referring to Ace there. I mean, even if Sabo was planned from the beginning, the specific timing of his reintroduction just kind of annoys me because he feels like a replacement for Ace. You know, Oda went to all this trouble to make an incredibly bold storytelling decision for One Piece, but then what happens when Luffy's cool older brother with fire powers passes away? Well, we don't need to worry because we'll just go down to the pound and find a new older brother with fire powers for him. To me, Sabo's existence in the modern timeline lessens the impact of Ace's death, and overall he just feels like a weaker version of Ace, not in terms of strength, but in terms of general characterization. And I don't think I'd be so bothered by that if he didn't have such a huge prominence in the story. Every time he reappears, I feel nothing at all really, whereas I'm certain that I'm supposed to feel some sort of excitement that this character is here. And I do have a lot more to say on the matter, but I could honestly make an entire video about it, and maybe I will. But for now, the general sense of flatness in such a theoretically important figure is why I cannot help but open this discussion with Sabo. Number 4. Momonosuke. Here we have a character who has landed on this list primarily due to the fact that he is a child. Child characters are notoriously difficult to write, especially when a story focuses on a cohort of significantly more interesting adult characters, because the problem with children is that they are either useless and need to be saved, used as a prop to motivate characters that we actually care about, or they are very, very useful, but incredibly arrogant and annoying as a result. And I'd say that Momonosuke falls into the first category of useless, which, you know, isn't his fault, that's just the nature of being a child. And as a result, when Momonosuke takes up some panel time, I often feel a bit robbed, because I know I'm not going to get much of interest out of him, except perhaps a motivation for other characters that I like a hell of a lot more to act. And sort of like the Sabo situation, that probably wouldn't be so bad, but Momonosuke happens to be an incredibly prominent character from Punk Hazard all the way to Wano, and possibly even beyond. Although I will say that Momonosuke certainly does have a chance to elevate himself in my eyes, because Wano is an arc that, for better or worse, will center on him somewhat. And should he be able to evolve and really come into his own, then that's a done deal. I will go ahead and find someone else to plonk on this list next time. But for now, I'm sorry, I just can't help but not really care one bit about Momonosuke. Number 3. Charlotte Pudding. So if you've been watching my manga or anime reviews for any amount of time, you were probably expecting this one, and you probably even understand why I'd place Pudding here. But for the fun of it, let's get into it again. The biggest problem I have with Pudding is her missed potential. When the chapter came around revealing her to be an antagonist plotting against Sanji, the Germa, and the Straw Hats, I was excited because it was a fantastic subversion of the traditional beautiful female One Piece character. Because, you know, usually they start off as an antagonist and turn into a protagonist. You know, like Viola, Boa Hancock, Nico Robin, etc, etc. But Pudding, no. She was here to change all of that, putting on the nice girl act and then becoming a huge antagonistic force. Oh wait, she fell in love and she's good now. Great. and I will accept that a lot of my disappointment stems from the expectations I put on a character rather than just going with the flow of the story. But even when I account for this, what Pudding becomes in my eyes was just a giant mess. After this point, Pudding was a wreck, flip-flopping between evil murderous intent and being all lovey-lovey-dovey, and always being played for comic effect. And it was a joke that was used so much in the tail end of Whole Cake Island that it became her entire character, not only making her that gigantic mess, but taking her one quirk and abusing it to the point where it just fell more and more flat in every subsequent use of it, making Pudding not at all compelling to follow, at least for me. I will say that Pudding did have one saving grace moment at the end of Whole Cake Island, because her parting scene with Sanji and her subsequent sobbing in the alley was genuinely touching. But it's because, just for this moment, all of her flip-floppy comic crap was dispelled and an actual character emerged. It's nowhere near enough to save her from being on this list today, but in all honesty, this moment is the only reason why Pudding isn't in the number one spot. Number 2. Gecko Moria. Here's one that I feel most people will find a bit more agreeable, but Gecko Moria is just not a character that I've ever been able to get on board with in any capacity. And a lot of that is for the rather superficial reason that I just hate his design. In a series full of left field designs, Moria comes out on top as one of the most bizarre and aesthetically off-putting things that has ever been put to paper. I mean, his shape, his attire, his dick neck, and that thing that we call a face, just all of it. What is this? But you know what? One Piece pulls that kind of stuff all the time, and I have long since learned that characters should not be judged simply by design alone. Unfortunately, Moria's character is equally as unappealing to me. His entire philosophy of becoming the Pirate King through the laziest means possible, whilst admittedly unique, does not endear me to him at all. And yes, he does have quite a potentially tragic backstory, one that I would be incredibly keen to explore, but that is not the Moria we experience. All we get are the results, and the results are essentially a sack of crap. The only positive thing I can say for Moria from my perspective is that I quite like his devil fruit abilities, but other than that, there is no excitement for me whatsoever when he appears in the series, and more often than not, he leaves me begging for a cameo from almost literally any other character. And I would like to emphasize that I mean almost any other character, because we still have to examine number one. Hody Jones. Here we are, my number one least favorite character in the entirety of One Piece. Hody Jones is a dude that I find simultaneously boring, annoying, aesthetically displeasing, and a complete apathy generator all at once. And this is a big problem, because on the back of this stunning specimen were the hopes of an arc that had been seeded in the series ever since the East Blue era. Fishman Island was so long awaited and a very sizable piece of story, something that very much required a strong villain to helm and tie it all together. And Hody did not deliver on that at all. He was physically weak, mentally dull, and his motivation for doing almost anything was kind of empty. And a lot of people will go on to argue that that was the whole point of Hody. He was there to highlight how ridiculous and simply vacuous racism can be. And I get that. But at the same time, that's not an excuse, because we've seen the theme of racism tackled more effectively than this, and not just in other media, but in One Piece itself with the Arlong arc. The sheer underwhelming nature of Hody is difficult to describe, really. He did not have the intellect or strength to be viewed as a real threat. And once again, I guess you can argue that that was the point of his character, especially as the rather unfortunate first main villain post time skip. But even if we were to accept that, the fact that he exists to be shit does not make him a good character. It makes him a shit character who is fulfilling his existence, which is to be shit. And that is why Hody Jones reigns supreme on this here list today. But that pretty much does it for my top 5 least favorite characters in One Piece. If you enjoyed this video and the content this channel produced in general, then please do consider donating to the Grand Line Review Patreon, because the support of all of you amazing people is what continues to make this channel possible. And if you'd like to see more videos like this but apply to other anime and manga series, then please do check out my second channel, New World Review, for all of your wider needs. And if you'd like to join the fun at any time, then please do head over to my Discord server, where a wide array of shenaniganry takes place on a daily basis. And finally, please do comment with your own least favorite characters in the series. This has been the Grand Line Review, and I'll see you next time. So whilst I'm clearly not much of a fan of the characters that I mentioned here today, I do certainly have to admit one thing. And that one thing is that they sure can dance.